What can user clip lanes be used for? This video is actually a background slash prerequisite material for a future tutorial on water rendering, but I decided to present this topic in a more general purpose way using a different use case. We are already familiar with the standard clip lanes, which are defined by the view frustum. These clip lanes help us deal with geometry which is entirely or partially outside the camera field of view. A user clip lane is exactly as it sounds. It's an optional clip lane which the user can place pretty much anywhere. For this reason, the results of the user clip lanes are much more evident compared to standard clipping, but the general principle is the same. It cuts through the geometry so that on one side of the plane we have nothing, and on the other side there may be new triangles in order to fill in the missing piece of the triangle. I have to admit that I'm not familiar with many usages for this feature, but I have been able to come up with at least one that you can see right here. The original model is of course a complete house, and the user clip lane allows us to dynamically cut it in different ways. Just add a few people and you have your own version of The Sims. Well, sort of. Alright, before we get started, I'd like to say a big thank you to Matthew, for Nickpick and Firefly in the Dusk, who recently joined the OpenGL Underground. If you too would like to support this channel, you can do that at patreon.com/OGLDEV or by joining the YouTube channel as a member. So let's refresh our memory on geometric planes in general. In simple words, a 3D plane is just an infinite and infinitely thin surface which divides the 3D space into two parts. One way to define a plane is using a single point which lies on the plane and a normal which is perpendicular to the plane. An interesting property of the plane is that one side of it is considered positive and the other negative. The positive side is the one which is pointed to by the normal. If we flip the normal, we have almost the same plane, except that the two sides switch roles. Negative becomes positive and vice versa. The general form of the plane equation in 3D is as follows. Notice that A, B, C, and D are scalar numbers, and X, Y, and Z is a 3D point. This means that we can take a point X0, Y0, Z0, substitute it into this equation, and if the result is zero, it means that this point lies exactly on the plane. If it's not zero, then the point is on one of the sides, depending on the sign of the result. After placing this point into the equation, we can extract D to one side of the expression. We can now substitute this version of D back into the original equation and get the following. After a bit of reshuffling, we get this. Notice that this is actually a dot product between two vectors. One vector is ABC and the other is a vector that goes from the point X0, Y0, Z0, which we know is on the plane, and the general point on the plane XYZ. The two endpoints of the second vector lie on the plane, which means that the vector itself is entirely on the plane. We also know that the dot product of two vectors which are perpendicular to each other is zero. This means that the vector ABC is perpendicular to the second vector, which makes it perpendicular to the plane itself. In other words, A, B, and C are not just a group of arbitrary scalar numbers. In fact, they are the normal vector of the plane. Another important property of the plane equation is that if the normal is a unit vector, then D is the distance from the plane to the origin. Let's see the relationship between D and the normal vector of the plane. Going back to the expression where D was extracted, we now understand that D equals to the negative of a dot product between the normal vector and the point on the plane. Let's calculate D when the normal of the plane points up and the plane goes through the point 0, 10, 0. The normal vector is 0, 1, 0. Taking the negative of the dot product between the two gives us minus 10. So the distance is actually the negative height of the plane. The reason is that we need to flip the normal back towards the origin and multiply it by 10 to get there. So basically, multiply the original normal by minus 10. If we make the plane go through 0, minus 10, 0, then d in this case is positive 10. So we just need to multiply the normal by 10 to get to the origin. This relationship makes it easy to calculate d in your head in simple cases and provide it to the application. But if you want to avoid making mistakes, you can always define the plane using a point and the normal vector and calculate d using the above expression. There are different ways to specify a plane, but I think that from a game developer's perspective, the normal and the point on the plane method is very intuitive. The general form of the sine distance between a point and the plane is given by the following expression. Sine the distance here means that if the distance is positive, then the point is on the side which is pointed to by the normal, and if it's negative, then it's on the other side. As you can see, when the normal vector is a unit vector, we can ignore the denominator, and we get a simple dot product between the vector ABCD and the homogeneous coordinate of the point XYZW, where W is 1. Now that we understand all of that, let's tie it back to OpenGL. You might expect OpenGL to provide an interface for specifying user clip planes using one of the above equations. Turns out that OpenGL doesn't care about any of that. It simply provides us with an internal array in the vertex shader called GL clip distance. The size of this array on the current platform can be queried by calling GL get and the enum GL max clip distance, but the minimum is guaranteed to be at least 8. This means that we have at least 8 user clip planes, which I guess should be enough for most use cases. Before using GL clip distance, we have to enable each slot individually using GL enable on GL clip distance and the index of the corresponding slot. As you may have guessed, what goes into the slots of GL clip distance is the sine distance of the vertex to the clip plane. I'm going to ignore points and lines here and focus exclusively on triangles. When a triangle is rendered, the sine of the clip distance of the three vertices is checked. If all of them are positive, the triangle continues to rasterization as usual. If all of them are negative, the triangle can be dropped. If we have a mix of negative and positive values, then the triangle is clipped at the exact point where the interpolated clip distance becomes zero. This will be done automatically by the OpenGL pipeline. All we have to do is calculate the 4D dot product between the position of the vertex and the user clip plane. Remember that when we have multiple clip planes enabled, the result is the intersection of all these planes. So let's see everything that we have learned in action. And remember, we start by enabling the clip distance, in this case 0, because I have a single clip plane. And I will also disable backface culling, otherwise the house will simply look weird, okay? Next, in our main render function, we create the plane normal and the point on the plane, and these are simply 3D vectors. And you can see that for the plane, we are setting it so that it will point downwards, okay? So y is minus 1. Z is 0, we don't care about that, and X is said to be the sine of this attribute, which is initially 0, but taking the sine of 0 is also 0, so this plane normal is initially pointing downwards. Now, you can change both the height of the plane and the angle by playing with these keys. Okay, so A and Z change the height of the plane. A increases the height and Z decreases the height, and X and C change the clip plane angle, okay, accordingly. And then you can point the plane to different directions as we saw earlier in the demo. So we have our plane normal pointing downwards, so we will see everything from this point and down. And this point, point on plane, is set at some height, which is initialized to 1 in this case, and we don't care about the X and the Z, so everything from a height of 1 and below will be visible, and everything above it will be clipped away. Okay, so if we would change this to be positive 1, then we will only see the top of the house, but we will not see the bottom. Next, we call set clip plane into the lighting technique, passing in the normal and the point on the plane. And what this does, here's the function, takes the normal and the point on the plane. It calculates D as we saw in the background section. Okay, so we take the dot product between the normal vector and the point on the plane. And remember that we need this in the negative. Okay, so now that we have D, we can construct our entire plane equation. Okay, so what we saw, A, B, C for the normal, in this case we have X, Y, Z from the normal vector, and D that we calculated here. And we can now send this as a 4D uniform into the shader, into the vertex shader in this case. And what we have in the vertex shader is a new uniform right here, G clip plane, okay, VEC4. And all we need to do is a dot product between the position of the vertex, and the clip plane. Okay, so the position of the vertex, which is initially a VEC3, is extended to a homogeneous coordinate with 1 in the W component. And remember that this is the local position of the vertex. So if you move the house around, clipping will not be affected. You always need to remember in which coordinate space you perform the clipping, whether this is in local, world, or view space. Okay, so the result of the dot product goes into GL clip distance and to the first slot. Okay, so we have a single clip plane here. Next, we render the house as usual. And after that, we render the ground. But in this case, I want the plane to simply point downwards without the angle. So I recalculate the plane normal and then set it into the lighting technique as before, and we continue to render the terrain. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you in the next tutorial.